No, you might totally embarrass
me. Now, I'm going to interrupt you. Yeah, you are a delight to talk to, man.
Oh, man, you are too. I dreamed about talking to you for so long.
This alien man tries to debunk the Bible, and it backfires. So make sure to watch till the end, because I have a Bible verse that will tie all of this together. Shout out to Cliff and give me an answer. Let's get right into it.
My question is, how come Matthew can be an eyewitness account if it quotes Mark, an earlier source? I think at least 25% of it's quoted from Mark.
Yeah.
How does that make that an eyewitness account rather than just another biography from the time period?
You bet.
The overwhelming evidence is, due to the writings of the early church fathers, that Matthew wrote Matthew, Mark wrote Mark, Luke wrote Luke, and John wrote John, in spite of the fact that you're very accurate. The original manuscripts, the earliest manuscripts that we have, do not have at the start the gospel according to Matthew, the gospel according to Mark. Okay, that was added. So you make a great point. But the eyewitnesses in the first century and those who knew the eyewitnesses insisted these gospels were written by these people. But even if they're wrong, it doesn't change the fact that the eyewitness community accepted Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John as historically reliable. Now, I like the way you're dressed.
Thank you.
Stuart has three daughters. They're my granddaughters, his daughters. Now, we're going to tell them, they're not here right now, but we're going to tell them about the privilege we had of talking with you.
Oh, thank you.
He's going to describe you, and I'm going to describe you. Our descriptions are not going to be precisely the same, right? He's going to give perspectives about how maybe how you nodded your head, maybe I will about how we shook hands, about the green suit. Okay? All right? And they're not going to be identical descriptions. That doesn't mean we're contradicting each other. See, what is an eyewitness account? It's a unique perspective. I'm going to talk to my wife tonight, who's up in Connecticut, and I'm going to tell her about you. Now, I'm going to include certain details, but exclude others. Stuart will include certain details and exclude others. If we are telling identical accounts of you, we probably were colluding. We probably were working together and saying, okay, this is exactly what we want to say about this dude.
Okay.
Who had a lot of guts to dress the way he did and come out here. And I like that. I respect that. Okay. So Matthew gives a unique perspective, Mark a unique perspective, Luke and John. Does that make sense?
Yes.
What do you think about Christ?
I think Christ is an interesting, exactly with his specific claims, I think they vary a lot gospel to gospel, like you were saying. I think John, it's very clear, he says, before Abraham was, I am.
Yes.
Very clearly saying, I am, me and God are equal, I and the Father are one.
Yes.
When you go back to a much earlier manuscript like Mark, it's these claims are wildly different. Now, you can mine, if you read deeply into the text, you can get Jesus saying, I am God. But it's much harder to get in these older gospels. And over time, in my opinion, I feel like these claims seem to grow in clearness and extravagance of who Jesus is over time.
Okay.
So I think the earlier gospels leave it way more up to interpretation about who Jesus is.
Okay.
Than the later accounts of his life.
Okay. Here's why I disagree. Please read Philippians chapter 2, written probably in the late 40s, early 50s. Before the Gospels. Paul unequivocally says, have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, becoming a bondservant. Then you read in Colossians chapter 1, Jesus is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. Once again, written in the late 40s, early 50s, before the Gospels. So you see, sir, my point is, regardless of how far back you push the historical record, you never come up against a non-supernatural Jesus. Mm. Jesus is worshipped as God right from the get-go. So the whole idea that has been taught on American university campuses, that you've done well articulating, which is later followers of Christ deified Christ, is false. Because when you push the record back right into the 40s, early 50s, you never bump into a non-supernatural Jesus. Mm. Does that make sense?
Yes. I'm curious, though, why you would think an account like John would be so clear with it, though, why an account like Mark would make it makes it much harder to read in the text. Why do you think that is?
I do not know.
Fair enough.
Why John wrote the way he did, why Matthew and Mark and Luke wrote the way they did. But I do know that if you read the Gospels, like Mark chapter 2, Jesus forgives the sins of a man he'd never probably seen before, who's lowered on a mat to his feet. And all the religious people, after Jesus says your sins are forgiven, shrink back saying, oh, time out. Only God can forgive sin.
That's right.
Who does this Jesus think he is? By claiming the right to forgive the sins of the paralytic, Jesus is claiming to be God. So it's not just his words, but it's also his actions where Jesus claims to be God. Does that make any sense?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good. I think reading the Gospels, you can't say anywhere that he's not claiming to be God. It's so evident, so clear that he's claiming to be God.
That's actually, I thought about the forgiving sins thing, but now that you're talking about it that way, now, you might totally embarrass me.
Now, I'm going to interrupt you.
Yeah,
you are a delight to talk to, man.
Oh, man, you are too. I dreamed about talking to you for so long. I've seen you on YouTube.
Sorry to hear that.
Like, you know, the rug cleaning videos. I'm like, man, I go to this university. I want to talk to Cliff one day. And now I'm hearing this alien talk, too.
Wow. There you go again.
I do got one more question for you.
You keep going, man. I interrupted you. You got the floor. Go for it.
Okay, so Joshua 6.
I'm going to make one more comment.
Yeah, of course.
I got frustrated yesterday, right? I meet this one guy on a sidewalk. He says, oh, I've seen your stuff on YouTube. And I said, okay, great. I said, he said, but I don't agree with you. I'm not a believer in Christ. I said, okay, fine. Can you come out tomorrow and ask questions? He said, no. I said, excuse me, why can't you ask questions? He said, because you've been doing this a lot longer than I have. So it wouldn't be a fair, really, debate. That's scary.
Yeah.
That is really scary. If you're so close-minded that you can't have an intelligent discussion about something, you are a narrow-minded person. So that's part of why I thank you.
Thank you.
So keep going.
So Joshua 6, this is, you know, Joshua brings the walls a-tumbling down of Jericho.
Yeah.
And it explicitly says that he killed every man, woman, child, and animal, and he dedicated the city to the Lord, and the Lord was with him. I have the quotes with me, but I think, is that about accurate, Joshua?
Wait a second. You have hyperbole in a lot of those passages. And the reason we know that is because often in later passages in Joshua or in Judges, we read that these Amalekites, these Canaanites, these Philistines, there's still a bunch of them running around. So no, they didn't literally kill everybody, but yes, they did kill some.
Yeah.
Not only that, when you study Jericho, you begin to realize that was probably a fortress.
Yeah, they found the actual ruins of the
city. Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
So no, it's not like the Israelites are going in and just saying, okay, here's a kid, let's cut his head off. No. No, they're going in and they're trying to move people out of the promised land who are trying to tempt them away from God.
And I see that, and that's definitely, so for me, this seems like this is just sort of an early Iron Age account of a siege and a city being taken.
Yep.
And that's pretty accurate with other communities similar.
Yes.
But this is the Bible, and God is supposed to be a figure above these human moralities. I just don't, there's no condemnation that comes from God, and the Bible even says the Lord was with him. You know, thou shalt not kill. Where's this condemnation of Joshua for what he did, which is, I mean, by all accounts, pretty immoral towards these civilians.
Very good. So I think at the root of your question is God allowed to judge? What do you think?
Supposedly he made us, so I'd say he has a pretty good chance to judge.
Very good. Because he made us, he's in a position where for him to judge us is fair. Okay? Now, if he chooses to judge me for the wrong that I've done, is there something wrong with that?
No.
Exactly. No. Because he's the one who gave me life, he's in a position to judge me. Second point. If some guy comes up to you and smacks you, steals your backpack, and I say to the guy, hey, let's go and go to Starbucks. Why is that so horrendous?
I'd have my feelings definitely hurt. That's my got all my stuff in there.
You really? Okay, the reason though I would argue that it would be so horrendous is if I love you and you get beaten up, and I say to the guy who beats you up, let's go to Starbucks. It means I don't love you. You don't matter. Mm-hmm. The dude can beat you to a pulp, and I really just want to go to Starbucks. Mm-hmm. See the problem with that?
Yes, of course.
Okay, so people who understand that break down in their thinking when it comes to God. They basically think that God is a nice Santa Claus who never keeps a naughty list, and everybody's cool. And God never judges. No, it's because God loves us, it's because we matter to God that God judges.
Yes.
Does that make any sense?
So you're saying he judged the people of Jericho.
Yes.
And I'm kind of with you on that with the adult males there. But what about, it specifically says children were killed. And this happens in wars all the time.
Yes.
I can't get my head around that. Those children didn't do anything.
Yeah, and it's difficult to say, like, why that happened, why children died. But, like, he's going to get into saying, like, there's consequences. There's lots of things happen because of our parents and what our parents do. And we don't know what those kids would grow up to do. And still, kids dying, obviously, terrible. Terrible, because we want to give everyone a chance to live. But the hyperbole thing is massive because we still see they didn't just like commit genocide against these people. You can still see them around in the Bible, in the biblical text. Well, I thought they killed everyone. Well, they didn't. So that's always something that's very important to think about. Ten Commandments, it says do not murder. There's a difference between those. So like war is maybe more justified. I don't know.
Bet. It's a hard issue, very hard. I agree with you 100%. Okay, now, in our culture, it's all about I'm responsible for my life, you're responsible for your life, and there's no mix-up.
Yes.
But we're beginning to study children of alcoholics. Mm. We're beginning to study children of divorce. And all of a sudden, we're beginning to realize, oh no, what mom and dad decided had tremendous repercussions in their children's lives, in their grandchildren's lives. Mm-hmm. So this whole idea that what I do is just my business, it doesn't influence you, mm-hmm. and what you do is just your business, it doesn't influence me, is a crock.
Certainly, certainly.
Right? So the Bible never says that those children are guilty of anything, but it does say that God judged the people of Jericho, different people groups who had rebelled against him, and yes, innocent people were swept along in the judgment. But that's also true of Noah's flood, the flood at Noah's,
certainly,
Noah's
yeah, yeah.
time, right? I mean, you bet. Because we're more interconnected than we would like to admit, innocent people are swept along in the judgment.
Mm. I mean, I guess it's me, just a simple alien man, to say God should have judged Joshua for this.
Yes.
The thing is, it said the Lord was with him after that, and for me, it just seems like this is like an account written by a human. It doesn't feel divinely inspired that there would be any repercussions for his attacking of civilians and children.
Yes. Okay, but please remember that a couple hundred years after that, God used first the Assyrians, who are a horribly barbaric people, and then the Babylonians, a horribly barbaric people, to judge the Jews. Mm. Now, why did God judge? Because both the Canaanites and then the Jews, both the residents of Canaan and the Jewish people, got to the point where they were saying, if you want to know God, have sex with a temple prostitute. And if you really want to get to know God, take your baby, put it on an altar, and sacrifice it to God. And God said, enough. If you do that kind of evil, it's time for me to judge you. And he judged them. Now, it once again gets back to this whole issue of free will.
Yes.
Haul back. Smack you. Okay, now wait, God, why don't you put plexiglass in between here so that my fist goes there and then bounces off?
Mm-hmm.
Because God has chosen to limit his power by giving us a free will, which means he's not going to put plexiglass here every time and my fist is going to bounce off. Instead, it could be that I would swing through, hurt you, and that's evil on my part. Okay? See, so it's this whole issue of expectations of an all-powerful God. What's an all-powerful God supposed to do? Put plexiglass here? Now, when he judges a people group, you're right. Innocent people are going to be swept along in that judgment. We cringe over that. I cringe over it. You cringe over it. And that's appropriate.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why we look forward to the return of Christ, when there will be a day of judgment, when injustice will be punished, and innocent people who've been raked over the coals will be lifted up.
Mm.
That's why this return of Christ is so important, because on that day, justice will really rule.
And in Revelations, where it talks about the return of Christ,
yes.
it seems to imply that much more people will also be swept up in this, right? There will be
years all of us
of torment. And I'm actually curious, what do you think about this idea of, what do they call it, the rapture? I seem to think that's not really in the text at all of
Good.
Revelation. What's your opinion?
I like your point. Stuart, how do you think through the rapture?
I think through the rapture as it's
predominantly metaphorical, but I have many close friends who believe that it's literal. So however Jesus is going to return and however he's going to reveal himself, I think everybody will have clearly a fair opportunity to see him and encounter him. So no, you as an atheist, I wouldn't focus too much so on the rapture. I'd focus more so on who exactly was Christ. And don't forget, these children that you're worried about, who I'm worried about as well, who are swept up into war and the atrocities of it, there's simply a change of location when it comes to heaven. Now, it's a painful one, obviously, for many of them. But don't forget as well, in an ancient Near Eastern culture, a lot of these children and kids were abused in a horrible type of way.
Yeah.
And so some historical scholars would say it's actually more of a gracious type of action. Now, I have a tough time getting my head around that one as well. And yet at the same time, how do we expect with our 21st century American, very American cultural lens, how do we want God to operate back in that day and age? Because so often it's, oh, I'm a white Westerner. Obviously, I know what human rights should look like. So God, you should have been operating thousands of years ago exactly in this kind of way. While those traditional cultures over in China, for example, in the Near East, they would say, what's your problem? You have a problem with children being swept along into judgment? Are you playing God? What's wrong with that? And they would have more so of an issue with, well, my ancestry, I want them all to be in heaven, but they might not all be Christians. So you see how these cultural issues really have a lot to do with where we were born.
Oh, certainly.
Does that make sense?
I totally see what you're saying, but I definitely do take a bit of an issue with what you're saying, like that it might have been a grace for these children, because unfortunately there are cults today where children are being horrifically abused, and I don't think them dying would be a grace for that. And that's not necessarily what you're saying, but if we put that into the modern day, I mean, it's God doesn't necessarily command Joshua to do this, but he dedicates it to the Lord, and the Lord doesn't say, I don't know. That's just like a big issue I kind of...
Well, and God, don't forget, in a humane kind of way, these civilizations would come overnight, like a thief in the night, and just wipe people out. We saw in the ancient Near Eastern culture. But Jesus Christ, specifically God in the Old Testament, was oftentimes getting 400 years, or hundreds of years as well, back all the way in Genesis 6 and before, with the flood. You're about to get stung here. Look at you.
Oh, thank you.
So I think it's important to remember, yet again, with our humane, you know, focus on humanity and how we want people to be treated.
Yeah.
Okay, well, God was very gracious, more gracious than most societies back then, for sure, when it came to the issue of slavery as well. I mean, you were to be put to death if you went and stole another person to put them into slavery.
Yeah.
So God is working with people. He's showing his grace, but at the same time, he's saying, turn from your evil ways. Now, I don't think it's true love. Back to my dad's point earlier. If he never shows justice, if he never has a type of judgment and just allow these people to continue in their evil ways with all different forms of prostitution, bestiality, on and on down the line, how is that really loving and guiding people along to a higher moral order? I don't think it is. I think that's unloving. See, we always ram against God and say, oh, he judged a people group. We hate him for that. He's not a loving God. But then he doesn't judge at other times, and we say, oh, he's not a good God because he let the evil get away with certain things. Do you see our double standard when it comes to judging God's moral character?
I certainly, and I'm with you basically on all of it, except for when it comes with the children that were slaughtered
yes.
in Jericho. And it's just, I don't know, it's just not, your points are well taken, but it just is not sitting for me that these children obviously do not deserve any judgment whatsoever. Because they were born into that, right? And it's like, I just don't see how it was moral for them.
So a terrorist in a home over in Iraq. Let's get real ethically gray here for a second. If his kids are in that house, but he's planning to blow up an entire city the next day, and he has the finger on the button himself, are you going to kill that terrorist and unfortunately his two children are going to be swept along to protect the entire city that he's going to blow up? Or are you going to say, nope, his two kids are in there, we can't drop that bomb, and I'm sorry, the 10,000 people in that city, they're going to die? See, I think it's, again, it's not clear, but yet at the same time, I understand why you would go the direction of, nope, his two kids will be swept along with him.
That's an interesting and difficult point.
That's a very difficult situation and question. I would like, obviously for me, I was thinking about like, there has to be a way without killing the kids, but wow.
for what you're saying is only the divine can make those.
Well, and just to finish with it, David, when he has the sinful relationship with Bathsheba, an adulterous relationship, he murders to get there, her husband Uriah, by putting him at the very front lines of the war. The baby is born, the baby dies. David says, I will go to be with him, he will not come to be with me, showing that children, especially in this case, born even out of sin, will be in heaven. Mm-hmm. So a child judged in that kind of way due to his father's sin as a terrorist, that child does not have moral culpability. And I believe that child will be in heaven. So a change of location.
Those Canaanite children.
So now I have a Bible verse that will tie all of this together. Isaiah 55:9 says, for just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. So there's so many things that we don't understand and can't comprehend, but I encourage you to just trust in God and know that he loves you. And I hope that you just put your faith in him and know that Jesus died on the cross for your sins so that you can be saved. In the description below, you can click the link to follow Jesus for the first time. It'll walk you right through that. That would be amazing. Anyway, guys, comment down below your thoughts on this, whatever that might be. Please like this video and subscribe. I'm trying to hit 20,000 subscribers by the end of the year, and I know we can do it with your help. So thank you for all your love and support. And guys, you might like this video here. Peace.